This is probably the most famous equation ever, E equals mc squared. And it means that matter can be converted into energy, right? Well, no, not exactly. It's not even the whole equation. Hey, crazies. This video was inspired by a question I got during a monthly live stream that I run for Patreon patrons and YouTube members. It's always a good time, and we'd love to have you join, but more on that later. This equation was first published a century ago in 1905, and people are still misunderstanding it. I'm not going to name any names, but I think this comes down to the language used by popular science explainers. We're going to get a little pedantic today, but I think it's necessary. With that in mind, for the sake of clarity, when I say the word mass in this video, I mean the invariant rest mass. As far as this video is concerned, relativistic mass, not a thing. Feel free to discuss in the comments, but that's the choice I've made today. Anyway, back in the day, our boy Albert was doing some math, naturally, and this relationship popped out for energy. You can see it's a little more complicated than the famous equation. It's got this big square root in the bottom. That root shows up like everywhere in relativity. We call it the relativistic factor, or the gamma factor, or the Lorentz factor. It's got a lot of names, is what I'm saying. Einstein went a little further with this, though, moving that root up in order to eliminate the fraction, and then expanding it using something we call the binomial theorem. It might seem a bit silly to turn this thing into an infinite series of terms, but sometimes we humans need to make things more complicated before we can make them simple. Math is no exception. With this expanded, we can distribute this other junk, and we'll notice something familiar. This is the equation for kinetic energy, which has been around for a few centuries. These extra terms are just relativistic correction terms. In plain English, we only need them if we're moving close to the speed of light. Fast, fast! If not, these terms are all tiny compared to this term. And we're left with something much simpler. The kinetic energy Einstein already knew about, and a new term, which he interpreted as rest energy. The word rest here meaning stationary. If you've got a book sliding across the table, it has some kinetic energy, but it will eventually stop. What Einstein's energy relation tells us is that book still has energy, even though it's not moving. It has an amount of rest energy equal to mc squared. And that is the familiar equation. So E equals mc squared doesn't tell us that mass can be converted into energy. It tells us that mass is energy. But it's even more profound than that. If this is the amount of energy anything with mass has when it's stationary, then any energy it has when it's stationary contributes to that mass. Does a full battery have more mass than an empty one? Yes. Does a hot pan have more mass than a cold one? Also yes. This is all the energy an object has when it's stationary. Literally all of it. This is one majorly profound conclusion, and it's only the beginning. Einstein's methods actually limited his perspective. He tended to do a lot of thought experiments, and he only used math when absolutely necessary. Looking deeper into this idea would require a mathematician. Q. Hermann Minkowski. He published his papers on the subject a few years after Einstein. And like a true mathematician, he generalized it to death. My man Hermann was the first to imagine space and time as one four-dimensional space-time. This fundamentally changed how we look at relativity, and it gave us a slightly different energy relation. This is still the total energy, the mass, and the speed of light. The P is momentum, which accounts for any motion. If you want to see a derivation of that, check out page 204 of my book. Links in the doobly-doo. If this equation applies to our sliding book from earlier, we can see it still reduces to the familiar E equals mc squared, once the book eventually stops. So nothing new yet. But let's compare it to Einstein's full version. Every single term in his version had a mass, which means it only applies to matter. But what about light? Well, Einstein's version doesn't work. Minkowski's version does, though. If we plug a zero in for mass, we ultimately get E equals pc. This is the energy of a photon, the particle of light. Minkowski's version applies to matter and light, which is everything. Well, at least it was back then, but let's stay on topic. For Einstein and Minkowski, matter was the stuff that had mass. Light was the stuff that doesn't. And I think this is the real source of confusion around E equals mc squared. The terms matter and mass are often used interchangeably, but they're not the same thing. Matter is just stuff that has a property we've assigned to it called mass. Mass is not a physical thing, it's an abstract number. And light has a similar confusion. The terms light and energy are often used interchangeably, especially in particle physics, but they're also not the same thing. Light is just stuff that has a property we've assigned to it called energy. Energy is not a physical thing either, it's also an abstract number, a number we can use in our mathematics. See, math is not fundamental to the universe or anything. It's just a tool that physics uses to make predictions and interpret patterns in reality. And as one of my old professors used to say, physics is in the language. When dealing with advanced physics like relativity or quantum mechanics, we have to be very careful with our language because we're discussing things in an unfamiliar realm. Say you've got an electron and a positron, a particle-antiparticle pair. When they collide, they cease to exist, and two photons are born. Did we just convert matter into energy via E equals mc squared? No! No, we did not! This is matter converting into light, not matter converting into energy. This light certainly has energy, but so do the electron and the positron. Those two also have a property called mass that the photons do not, but only because some of their energy happens to be confined. That's it. Matter and light are physical things we can observe. Mass and energy are just mathematical quantities. We made them up. But that doesn't mean they're not real. Lots of stuff is made up and real at the same time. Money is a perfect example. It's an abstract quantity that we've assigned to economic transactions. Measurements like mass and energy have a similar existence. First, we observe that something like matter has a behavior, like this sliding book slowing down. But we also notice that it doesn't stop instantaneously. The book is somehow resisting that slowdown. It's a behavior we call inertia, and mass is a quantity we often assign to quantify inertia. Why do we do that? Because it's useful. That definition allows us to write equations like Newton's second law of motion. The friction on the book, divided by its mass, predicts a certain amount of slowing. And that prediction matches reality. Useful! Now let's look at energy. It happens to be the same before and after this reaction. It might have changed forms, mass and kinetic energy before, and photon energy after, but the total amount never changes.
Conservation of energy shall not be violated!
We've defined energy in such a way that it obeys that rule, which allows us to predict how energetic the resulting photons will be, among other things. Energy and mass are useful, and the way we define properties like that will determine what the equations look like. Rest energy might be E equals mc squared if you measure energy in joules, mass in kilograms, and the speed of light in meters per second. But we don't have to use standard units like that. Remember, we made all this up, like we made up money. We could just as easily measure all speeds as a multiple of the speed of light, in which case c equals 1, and the equation is just E equals m. Or in English, rest energy is mass. Which, to be honest, is a pretty common thing to do in relativity. The point is, we decide how the measurements are defined, and we decide what units are used. Those choices then determine what the equations look like. It's all made up. Math is not reality, but it has the power to tell us about reality, if we use it properly. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. Direct viewer support has been my main source of income ever since I stopped taking sponsors and removed all the mid-roll ads for my videos. I intend to keep doing that through 2025. So if you have it to spare and feel that I deserve it, please consider supporting the channel. I have plenty of support options listed on my website, but Patreon patrons and YouTube members specifically get access to a live monthly Q&A. It's basically an AMA, everyone keeps me on my toes. Great time, highly recommend. You might even ask a question that inspires a video, like Warren did for this one. And thanks to everyone who already supports the channel. You're what allows this to be my job. I'm eternally grateful. For those of you who didn't notice, my previous video had an error in it. I had to take it down and re-upload a corrected version about 48 hours later. You might want to go re-watch it if you caught it early. For those of you who did notice, the support you've given me for the decision has been overwhelming. Thank you so much. And thanks to everyone for watching.